Hey guys, it's Queen Mercy, your badass brand coach, and we are back today with another episode of the Black Brand Weekly. I'm super excited to get started. So, in case you guys aren't aware, I don't currently have access to my Facebook page. Something crazy happened, and right now I am waiting on Facebook to hit me back so that I can, you know, basically know when I'm going to be able to get access to my page again, if at all possible. So anyway, we're gonna rock with it. So today, let me just do a quick intro. In case you don't know me or you haven't been to my page, it's been rebranded a few times because, you know, things happen. You shift focus and life goes on. I'm Queen Mercy, your badass brand coach, and I lead minority brands to scalable, profitable six-figure businesses through mindfulness, marketing, advertising, and automation. To learn more about my services and get on my badass email list where I send out things like the Black Brand Partner Referral Network. Emails where we are exchanging opportunities and contracts and, you know, ways to collab and make money, as well as, you know, free downloads from the Black Brand Weekly series and exclusive other things, events, whatever. Get on my email list, contact me for private coaching and all that good stuff, badassmybrand.com. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and jump right into it because, you know, we don't like being on CP time. We like being on time so that we can move on with the rest of our day, right? Today we are going to be talking about Kanye. So in case y'all haven't heard or seen, or you've been living under a rock, or you've been just, your mind been blown from everything that's going on with COVID, whatever. Kanye has finally been acknowledged by Forbes as a billionaire. So if you guys know Kanye, he's really big and boldly, like, he says whatever comes to mind. He don't care who like it. We don't talk about that. And it's just him being recognized by Forbes is such a big thing that he's sharing it with the world. So he did like a whole video and they released it this weekend. So Forbes did a whole big article on him, which is so funny because they just released their list of 2020 billionaires. He wasn't on it last month. And so now he gets his own feature. So I'm sure that was very strategic and I'm sure that was a very Kanye West thing to do. But we are going to talk about that. So let's talk about a little bit of his trip, right? His journey, because if you guys are like me in my age range, when Kanye first hit the scene, we were in our teens. Like, I mean, hit the scene hard. Like, he had had, you know, music out and he had been in the industry, the game for a minute, but he didn't actually really get big until after his crash. And at that point, I was a teenager. So college dropout was everything for me. Like, I mean, the evolution of his music, where he is today, I don't identify with anymore. We are going to talk about that. But, you know, just, hey, Boss and Floss, thanks for joining in. So, just like from the start, his whole journey has been very interesting to follow. Anyway, let me just go ahead and get into it. Okay, so I will share the link. If you guys haven't seen it already, I'll share the link so that you guys can actually read the full excerpt from Forbes. Kanye is definitely an anomaly. His brain is very unique. He's a mad genius. And, you know, even though I might not resonate with his music right now, like where his music is right now, it's still very relevant and a lot of people like it. So we're just going to talk about a little bit of his transition. So from, hey, you can, thanks for joining in, family. Some of my Canon fam there. So in case you haven't actually followed his transition, I mean, when he first came out, he was super humble, right? He was very relatable. He was still a little arrogant, but he had his grandma in his life. His mom was still around and he just went through, he was just a kid basically coming into the industry. And then we got Ivy Produce with them hot beats. Oh, man. Ivy Produce just jumped in. Okay, so You Can and Ivy Produce, if you're on IG, You can EU.CANN and Ivy Produce, Ivy Produced, Ivy Produced. These two are on fire, two of my Canna family. Ivy Produce produces music. He has some hot beats, some hot joints. Please follow. You can, they do a lot of consulting and educative, educational types of events in the cannabis space. So please check them out. If you want to know how to start a black cannabis business or a minority owned cannabis business, or if you want to know anything about the cannabis industry, I strongly advise you go over to UCAN's page. If you want to hear some hot beats, buy those beats, sample them for your videos, have some creative content for your videos, go over to Ivy Produced, his page, so that you can check out his different packages available. So make sure y'all go and support each other. These are all black businesses. Support, support, support. Anyway, so College Dropout is like one of those albums that you could play from front to back, right? And we loved everything about Kanye. He had this huge story. He was in the media. I mean, the people really centered around him, from, you know, Jesus Walks to, I mean, just everything. I mean, the man is a genius. He went back and touched on the things that were part of his brand, part of his life, and how he became who he was. And if y'all didn't realize, at that point in time, he was with Alexis, who was a Delta. She was a sister. She was a, you know, she was black. Y'all know he had a whole completely different, he had a unique evolution process. I mean, and then he was this authentic, like he was this authentic person, right? Like he has always been very vocal about everything that's going on in his life, things that he's interested in, things that he's doing, projects he's working on, the way he's feeling, things that, you know, are happening, like when his mom passed from that surgery. I mean, nobody could have expected like the type of, to grow up in the media and to experience the type of things that he experienced in under such a magnification glass. He really did grow up before us, and you know, he was just super humble when he first came out, and we love Kanye. I can't speak for people today. I don't know. My husband still listens to him. I don't still listen to him. His music doesn't resonate with my, you know, my, where I am now, but still got love for him. So we're going to go ahead and highlight some of the ways that his brand came to be exactly what it is that today, this billion-dollar black brand. Don't play no games. He done outranked Hove now. Hove, you know, Hove and Bae collectively are worth $1 billion. But again, and this, I talked about this in building a brand that people love and getting people to pay you to love you and pay you for exactly who you are. I talked about that in my last live last week. It is about the audacity of authenticity. You have to be willing to be exactly who you're going to be, right? Be comfortable in being who you're going to be, because if that's who you are, then people will see you for you and respect you for you. You know, look, I'm just going to be honest. Everybody doesn't like badass as the name. Everybody can't own that and say, you know, what's badass or what makes you so badass. That's a big proclamation to make about yourself. Look, my dogs are scratching at the door. That's a big proclamation to make about yourself, that you're a badass, that you're a badass brand culture, whatever it is. But for me, I've always been unapologetically just who I am. I really don't mind people being, you know, off put by my name. I don't care what background you come from. I'm not particularly religious, and I don't, you know, curse words don't scare me. I'm married to a Marine, so there's no way curse words could be any part of scary to me. But you know, that is just that's part of my brand. So one thing that I would say about Kanye, and that's something that you can adapt into your brand, these are practices that you should absolutely be taking advantage of. These are things that you should be doing, and that's being your authentic self. When you show up as 100% you, people see you for exactly who you are. They come to know you, they come to love you, and they come to accept exactly who you are. They come to know, trust, and like your brand enough to invest in your brand and to buy your product, services, solutions, platform, whatever it is that you're offering. Okay. So from the humble college dropout, kind of that era of Kanye West, to the just after his mom passed, you know, he really went through a whole change, a whole evolution. And he was, you know, his music took a dark turn to My Dark Twisted Fantasy. And so he just really kind of went to a dark space. And since then, you know, the whole leaving the girlfriend, the Amber Rose situation, and then the Kim K situation, his choices as to who he was surrounding himself with changed for the negative, but his brand kept growing. Because let me tell you a little bit of something about America and the American audience. And you know, I'm all the way real. I don't show anything that I'm not comfortable with saying publicly. And I'm just going to be 808 and heartbreak. Absolutely. 808 and heartbreak was when it changed. And then My Dark Twisted Fantasy. Yes. Thank you, producer. Thank you, Ivy Produce, for straightening me out. Yes. 808 and heartbreak. And then My Dark Twisted Fantasy. And it was like, oh, okay. He went all the way off the left end. Anyway. So, y'all.
I think
they came after. My husband just scared the shit out of me, y'all. He is at the door listening to my live. Thank you. I appreciate you, baby. He just scared the hell out of me. So.
Yay.
So. I'm not even going to talk about the fact that, look, I'm not here to talk about conspiracy theories or whatever, why people go crazy in the music industry or why they make the choices that they make. I will say, having been in the media and production and communication side of marketing for so long, there are powers that be at play, right? You're not going to just promote. Listen, I've been fired for things for lesser than going on and saying black is beautiful. I've been fired for saying, you know, hey, listen, in this ad, if you're going to try to reach a black audience, you need to have a black woman, not a white woman in this ad, because 70-something% of households are, you know, monitored. Those budgets are managed by black women. And if we see a white woman in our place in the ideological black family, we're not gonna buy that product. I've been fired for less than things that Kanye West has done, but that's what it takes to build your own brand, to have the audacity of authenticity. This guy has come out and said, listen, Taylor Swift, I know you popping it right now, and I know people love you, but Beyonce had the hottest album of all time. Get your ass off the stage, bitch, right? Like, he was really, really serious about what he said. He was probably on drugs at that point in time. He probably was a little drunk, but he said what he said, right? Those things made the black audience love him, but made the white audience hate him, right? So that authenticity, it scares certain people. And I'm not even going to talk about the higher powers that be in the music industry. Those people, there are conglomerates who literally control the Washington Post and the New York Times and et cetera. Rupert Murdoch owns 70% of the music and television, of the news and television industry. Let me tell you, Rupert Murdoch is one of the most racist people out here on the face of the earth. Some of the stuff that he said, it's unfathomable. Some of the stuff that's come out of his mouth. But he owns Fox News. You know what I mean? That's why it's an agenda. It's an agenda. So long story short, AB, thank you. What's up, A? I see you, brother. So when Kanye says things like, hey, this black woman had the best album of all time, etc., that scares the shit out of white people. They don't like that, you know? So that's very off-putting to his brand. But when he started to date lighter and lighter, to eventually he was no longer dating black women, and then he was just dating non-black women, and then he started to integrate with his audiences. Come on, Yeezys. Who buys Yeezys the most? Let's talk about this, okay? Let's think about the idea behind Yeezys and who's actually in the price range to buy Yeezys. Who he is catering that brand to. Yeezys are a white brand. It's a black brand catered to a white audience. White people want to know what it feels like to be black. This gives them a glimpse into what it feels like to be black, to feel, you know, hood, or to feel like they're part of the in crowd, to feel popular, because black people have always set the pace for this. And this isn't a race thing. It is, but that's just America. That's just the scope of America. But I'm not trying to make it a black versus white thing. This is just the reality of what it is, okay? So when you think about the price point of Yeezys and who it's marketed towards, have you ever really seen it on a BET channel? Have you ever really seen it advertised on BET? Where do you see Yeezys advertised on MTV, on, you know, these game apps and things like this, where these wealthy kids who have these wealthy parents can go out and buy them a $1,300 pair of boots or shoes that are, I mean, for all intents and purposes, completely impractical. I mean, they're ugly. It's ripped. It's torn. It's bleached. It's whatever. It looks like shredded army fatigue. And I'm not ripping on his brand. I'm just saying this is just, yeah. Yeah, I'm gonna leave it where it is. So a little bit more about you know, his transcendence into, you know, the different cultures of America. And he kind of, yes, okay, y'all. So if you're on IG, Ivy Produced just said slave clothes. Yes. That's why you don't see black people walking around, running around in it. We have been, for generations, for millennia, we have been kept from having nice things, from having education, from being of the middle class, from being of the accepted class, from everything. So we're not going to be running around in $1,000, $100 ripped clothes. I mean, some people do it, you know, but honestly, that's not me. If my clothes got rips in them, then I'm not paying hundreds of dollars for them. I may have on some husband or boyfriend jeans with the little rips in them from Banana Republic that cost $100, $75. But, you know, I'm spending money on things that are polished, and that's just my style. I'm going to tell you, everybody don't roll with that style. And, you know, some people like the slave look, but black people were enslaved long enough. We're not going to be running around looking like no tattered slaves for hundreds and thousands of dollars. So just think about the perception of that, who he's actually marketing that product to, okay? So just understand who that product is geared towards and how he's reaching that $1 billion. Now think of it, Joel Osteen. He's going live with Joel Osteen and doing this Christian stuff, and he's really monetizing his brand in white markets and really making himself a safe household name. He's got a white wife or a non-black wife. He's got, you know, a product that caters directly to white people. He's got this white audience, this huge and evangelical Christian audience who, you know, if they actually listen to his music, I'm not even going to go there. But he's profiting from a market that he's willing to cater to in order to hit that $1 billion mark and above. Your brand does not have to cater to that market, but if you're okay with catering to that market, then by all means. But he had to pull back from that audacity of authenticity that I talk about so much, because that scared his market, and he had to make moves that would allow his market to be more profitable. He has now hit that $1 billion mark before Beyonce and Hov, right? Collectively, they've hit it together, but singularly and individually, they have not. So, having the audacity of authenticity is one of the biggest things that you can do for your brand. It doesn't matter what market you cater to. I specifically cater my brand to black and minority audiences, because we have been under for so long. It's time for us to be above. And the strategies that I've learned and leveraging from working in corporate America, when I work with primarily non-minority companies, agile movement, waterfall training and waterfall scheduling for projects, and, you know, just different ways to scale our brands, automations, having systems and tools in places, you know, mindfulness, these concepts are concepts that aren't, you know, typically cater to African American and minority communities, especially when it comes to having a small business, because we don't have the budget to really implement these things starting out if you don't already have a lot of capital or a large amount of capital. But that's why I focus specifically on these things, to help us build stronger, profitable, pivotable, agile, adjustable brands that allow you to scale your brand no matter where you are in the world. And that's the reason why I bring those tools and resources from white corporate America into black small business and into black Main Street, because we deserve to have brands that are leverageable, that are profiting, that make money for us while we sleep, etc. So those are the reasons why I cater to the market that I cater to, and why I use mindfulness, marketing, automation, and advertising to help us scale our brands, because it's so important. With that, the power of authenticity is crazy, because with your customers, that is how you overcome that, what do they call it? Imposter syndrome, okay? You will hear a lot of brand marketers and a lot of online coaches and a lot of online educators talk about imposter syndrome a lot. Basically, what that is, it's the lack of confidence or a lack of true direction, purpose, and clarity surrounding your brand. When you don't have those things surrounding your brand, you're like, who am I to say that I'm the badass brand coach? Who am I to be leading these brands? How can I make them successful? How can I really allow people? Dave, what's up, Etch Man? I see you. Thanks for joining in. So when you're talking about those brands, when you're talking about leading people to whatever it is that you tell your customers or your clients you're going to lead them to, being able to effectuate true change in their lives, that takes a couple of different things, okay? And mindfulness is at the crux of it. This is why I'm so big about mindfulness and meditation, because that is really how you get in touch with your true purpose. That's why how you find your true north, how you identify with who you are on the inside and what you should really and could really be offering to people. If you are not on a plan to scale your brand to $10,000 months, because once you reach a $5,000 or $10,000 month, you can reach a $100,000 month, and then you can reach a $500,000 month, and you can reach a $1 million month. You can really have your brand set up for success, but it's all about having the right systems and tools in places, in place. And I use a simple four-step solution of mindfulness, marketing, advertising, and automation to help brands get there. What you need to do is find those pillars, those foundational identifying factors that set your brand apart from everybody else, and shout that shit from the rooftop. And I am not joking when I say that. I mean, it should be everywhere. It should be on every social media channel that you're on. It should be on all of your email lists. You should be talking about the way that you, like, when you go live, I introduce myself. I tell you guys who I am, because a lot of you don't know who I am. So I get that. I deal with private clients on a very private end. And I'm just now to the point where I'm like, okay, Mercy, you got to get up off your butt. You're going to have to do something with these social media accounts so that, you know, you can really build your following. And that is just how it is in this day and age. Everybody is digitally wired. So if you are not actually speaking who you are and what you do and putting it out there, then how on earth do you expect people to know who you are and how to be attracted to your brand, how to like your brand, how to follow your brand, and get to know and trust your brand enough to buy from you, to support you, to become a subscriber, to get on your email list, etc. So have the audacity to be authentic in exactly who you are. Secondly, virality, okay? There is a process to getting to going viral. Start with those free social media channels. Start with TikTok. Start with Instagram. Start with, you know, Snapchat, YouTube, Facebook. Start small with things that are free for you. Start to scale yourself with advertising. And then once you get a following that's big enough, then you've got e-blast to 10,000 people. Maybe just you're starting with one person to 100 to, you know, 1,010. Everybody starts somewhere. The people that you love, the people that you see, Coach Stormy and Simone B, and, you know, your favorite is coach, your biggest fan, whoever your favorite person is, those people that you follow, those people they started from absolutely nothing, just like you. So if you're starting from nowhere, or you're looking to rebrand yourself, or how to figure out how to rebrand yourself or get your brand to the next level, how to scale your brand, start free. Don't start with something that's going to cost you thousands of dollars a month, like a radio or television ad. What are you promoting on radio or television if you don't have a product yet, or if you don't know if your product is a viable product, if it's actually effective and useful? And you'll know that your brand is effective and useful because you have people paying you to do exactly what it is that you do, which is be authentically you. I don't do anything in my coaching other than be authentically me and lead people to the resources that they need to escalate their brand and scale their brand to the level of their dreams, no matter whether it be 100,000 followers for the month, or 10,000 downloads on an app, or, you know, 100 signups on their course, or 100 subscribers to their email list, all the way up into, you know, if you want to be a multi-million dollar brand, then we literally sit down and we talk about, okay, what are your monetization avenues? What are the different streams of income that you have coming in your brand? Okay. How many people do you need to close via that stream of income? How many subscribers do you need to get on your email list to convert whatever percentage of your email list into clients? How many calls do you need to be making? How many emails do you need to send? What does it sound like? What does it look like? How do you get in touch with those people? Where do you find them? Okay, have a strategy. Their success, I promise you, success is a strategy. Success, there are definite steps that you can take to get there. And I talked about those before, and I'll talk about them again. I actually still have them here. And a lot of them, this is why I'm such a big proponent of mindfulness. I almost laugh to myself when I talk about how much I talk about mindfulness and how much I bring it up, because it's so important. Mindfulness is about following your breath, right? It's about tuning everything else out and focusing on one thing in specific. And when you can learn to do that for yourself, then you can learn to do that anywhere in the world. Sometimes when you're upset or you're in a tense situation, you can literally, you have the equanimity, the power and potential to be quiet and silence everything else and pull yourself together and say, okay, what can I do about this situation? That's why I say turn the news off and turn your brain on. The news is nothing but noise. It is distraction. It is distraction. One of my favorite quotes, I'll actually have to post it because I don't remember it all the way from beginning to finish, but it's basically saying if you want to know people who are all about the news, then, you know, if you want to know what happened in the news, then look at last week's news clippings, etc. Like, you catch up on news when you need to catch up on it. But basically, don't let that be everything that you are. Turn the radio off, turn the news off, and really get focused. So here are my 7 steps to success through mindfulness. These are different things that you can, these are different factors that you will benefit from when it comes to mindfulness and meditation. And then these are things that you're going to be using to grow your brand, right? Focus. The focus that you get, that you learn from meditating, really enables you to have clarity, okay? Clarity in your brand, in your purpose, in your mission, etc. Concentration. Concentration is the ability to endure, right? To stay on one task at a time, to be a master of that. You do not want to be a jack or Jill of all trades and master of none. You need to be able to focus on one thing and keep that thing intact and then move on from that, right? You can crank out an ebook in a week. You can do whatever it is that you want, but you need to focus on that one thing, master that one thing, be badass at that one thing. And then once it's off your plate, it's done. It lives in perpetuity because you are all about evergreen marketing because you've been consulting with me. So you know how to make that thing live so that it's consistently accessible 24/7 and people can buy your ebook or download your ebook from anywhere, anytime in the world, even while you sleep. That way you wake up and in your Square app or your PayPal, you got money in the bank, okay? If you don't have that, then you need to go to badassmybrand.com and get started on your free badass brand strategy review, because we will talk about ways to monetize your brand and whatever. Get on my email list, do all that good stuff, badassmybrand.com. Thirdly, execution. Execution is just performance, right? Hey, boo, I miss you, Vita. So execution is the performance, what you're putting into it, what ebook you're creating or what course you're creating or et cetera, you know, all that good stuff. What's your product? What's your service? What are you giving to the world? What are you promising them to have? Production, output, that is your, what you give to people, it's energy, right? So if my production or my output is my next course, or which I actually have coming up, I've got a mindfulness and money mastery course, a class where we're going to do live meditation, and you're going to get a workbook to go with it. And we're going to overcome those fears, and we're going to talk about your money and your mindfulness and get you on par to building your first $10,000 month in your brand. That's coming in May. I cannot wait to share that with you guys. If that is my output, right? That's what my energy that I give to people. Then the next step is the results, the energy and the feedback that you guys will give to me. So say if my output is the course or the class, then the energy is how many people it resonates with, how many people are paying me to join my class so that we can meditate together, so that we can manifest together, so that we can make this money together. We're going to plan and strategize to have your first $10,000 month. And then from there, we're going to scale your brand up to a $100,000 month. And then next thing you know, you're going to have $1 million years, just like some other people that I know. So you have results. That's the energy. That's the feedback. And then you repeat. You have that cycle. You put it on repeat. You automate it. And then you do that for brand after brand, or ebook after ebook, or course after course, or product after service, etc. Okay? That is how you build a brand. And honestly, it is just simple steps. And the main ones are consistency, action, endurance, having that concentration, that ability to endure and keep moving, output, putting something out, getting something out there into the world, getting that energy and that feedback, and repeating that whole cycle again. Success is indeed a cycle. It is not difficult. It's difficult. It's a challenge. It's a journey. It's not easy, but it is not unattainable, you know, and it's very readily available to you, but you have to have the systems and tools in place to be able to achieve that. So we talked about Kanye and the different steps, the audacity of the audaciousness and audacity of authenticity. We talked about actionable things that you should be doing in your brand to being authentic and having scalable automations in place, things of that nature to really grow your brand. And the seven steps to get you from point A to point B in your brand, from you know, slugging and kind of just out there wading in the water to successful and living a life of abundance and of freedom. Those things are achievable through mindfulness. And that's why I'm such a huge proponent of mindfulness. That's why mindfulness is built into everything it is that I do and everything that I offer in my courses, private coaching, and on my website. So any questions, anything, please feel free to jump on over to my website, badassmybrand.com, or drop your email below in the comments and I will share. I'll add you to my email list. And I am just super excited to work with you guys and come through any questions, any way that I can help, any way that we can support each other. If you want to be on the Black Brand Referral Network, where I send out an email at least once a month with different opportunities and contracts and partnerships from other Black brands, then jump on my email list at badassmybrand.com or drop your email below. And I look forward to seeing you guys on the next Black Brand Weekly, which is going to be next Thursday at 7, and hopefully I will have my Facebook access back. So tonight we're on IG Live, and this will be taken down. Of course, IG only lasts for 24 hours, these stories, but I will post this on my YouTube as I do the other Black Brand Weeklies by Sunday at 8. So I look forward to seeing you guys on the next Black Brand Weekly, and thanks for coming through. Have a good night.